Channel 2, WBBM-TV, Chicago.
For our times will not be seen today, so that we may bring you a special St. Patrick's Day program.
A father, a apple, a rock to my frog, gal. When ik mer bale, helar an awud. Gawig yele, a hawwide. Gagwine shib mokhra, gal.
The language is Gaelic, the ancient Celtic tongue of Ireland. The poem, read by Ireland's foremost actress, Siobhan McKenna, constructs an imaginary dialogue between Jesus and his mother. The words were scribbled in a manuscript margin over 1,000 years ago by an unnamed Irish monk. They are echoes from that formative time in Western history when Irish monasteries were the fortresses of European learning and culture. At the time of the decline and fall of Roman civilization and the onset of the Dark Ages, groups of the last unconquered Celtic peoples living on the outer fringes of the known world began freely to adopt the new religion called Christianity. Out of that conjunction came a distinctive flourish of Celtic art and a dynamic religious culture that played a vital role in preserving and rekindling the heritage of the Western world.
CBS News presents Lamp Unto My Feet. Today, Irish Celtic Arts. The narrator is Don Hastings.
Ireland can still be seen today, in many places, much as it must have appeared to the earliest Stone Age men to come upon these rocky green slopes and game-filled forests. As the last ice age receded from the European continent, land bridges opened the way for the first known men, primitive hunters and fishers, to range this island just 8,000 years ago. They left few clues and no arts or monuments to themselves, even though they lived here quite undisturbed for over 2,000 years. The first agricultural people, an invading breed of Stone Age settlers, made their way to Ireland sometime around 3500 BC. Who they were, these first Irish farmers and herdsmen, is still shrouded in the intriguing mysteries of their burial sites. They were a religious people, whose rough slab tomb monuments like these, called dolmens, can still be seen scattered about the Irish landscape. Their leading families raided an even more elaborate and enduring memorial in what are called passage graves, large, dugout, stone-supported burial rooms reached through narrow tunnels. Some of these tombs required the assembly of over 12,000 tons of rock. Here were the earliest Irish decorative carvings on the entrance stones and support pillars of tombs like this at New Grange. The markings are simple, repeated abstract patterns of lines, angles, and curious spirals. Very often they are grouped in threes. There is no apparent attempt to represent anything. The designs are pure and almost mathematical. Most likely they were a form of insurance, a protective magic or powerful religious symbol to guard the journey of the deceased. Whatever they meant, they obviously fascinated and influenced all the later Irish artisans and design makers. Variations of these themes are found on virtually all subsequent Irish art. The next great wave of immigrants to Ireland were primitive metal workers, copper miners, and makers of bronze farming and household tools. They arrived about 2000 BC. They discovered gold soon after and began crafting sophisticated ornaments to wear. They were fairly skilled artisans. These distinctive gold objects are necklaces. These are earrings. And these are dress fasteners that work much like modern cufflinks. Some of the styles and techniques of fashioning metal were taken up and gradually transformed by the last and most important pre-Christian people to occupy Ireland. These were the Celts. Celts were already an ancient people in 600 BC. By that time, they had spread from their homeland in Central Europe to every corner of the continent and parts of Asia. They were rough, unvarnished people, as these self-portraits show. They were iron users and chariot warriors, more fearsome than the bronze weapon makers they conquered. But the Celts themselves were outclassed by the organized might of Mediterranean armies. For 1,000 years, European Celts struggled with the expanding worlds of Greece and Rome. Ireland absorbed from those contests wave after wave of Celtic warriors and refugees. The Roman Empire reached its farthest outpost in northern Britain. But across the Irish Sea, the other island, Ireland, was still a refuge. Here, an undiluted Celtic culture thrived long past its prime elsewhere. These are gold torque neck rings, traditional symbols of high social rank. Some Celtic craftsmen freely borrowed Roman customs for their own designs. When these brooch pin patterns were adapted to swirling Celtic gold motifs, they were made with pins that didn't work. An intriguing insight into Celtic religion was this three-faced stone head of a god. Mostly unimpressed with Roman ways, the Irish remained defiantly rural and traditionally Celtic. No cities or towns existed. Family kinsmen and tribes were organized in small kingdoms. Wealth was counted in cattle. The forests were the preserves of the Druids. Druid meaning lover of oak. The Druids were the learned priestly class who preserved all knowledge, law, and tradition in memory and passed it on to sons by word of mouth. Writing seems to have been taboo. Part of the Druid power was in religion and their secret way of dealing with the array of nature, gods, and spirits that they saw as rulers of these Irish lakes and glens. Christianity did not come suddenly to Ireland, although to judge by the great monastic sites and their material ruins, it seems to have been planted everywhere, full-grown and firmly set like the trees and rocks beside them. From about 400 AD until the early Middle Ages, Ireland became the creative center of a flourishing Celtic Christianity. There had been no large structures anywhere in Ireland until the rocks were raised up into monasteries. These new settlements became a vital social institution. Like new towns, which in a sense they were, the great monastic communities absorbed, awakened, and channeled the talents of the population. Before the monasteries came, the Irish were a pre-literate people, storytellers only. They were renowned poets, makers of laws, and fair historians. But there was till then no written record. The monasteries became for them, as time went on, university, art center, plantation, church, and social center all in one. Here, the learning that was possible with written literature also fixed in written words the long history, the sagas and legends, the tales of cattle raids and wars of the Irish kinsmen and their kings. There was also no settled social order. Some 150 tuatha, or petty kingdoms, vied with one another for plunder and for power. Only later did a loose allegiance grow around three high kingdoms, in Armagh, Cashel, and at Tara. At Tara, ancient home site of the most powerful kings, the Enail, the only monument today is raised to Patrick, the Roman, British, Irish saint, solely credited with the religious transformation of all Ireland. At Cashel, where another of the three great powers, the Onnacht kings of Munster, held sway, a monastic church ruin crowns the rock rise. Rebuilt many times, it is a jigsaw of period fragments. Some old Celtic sculptured motifs have been preserved from previous monastic structures. Here a Celtic chieftain, and here a hunt. And here is preserved a fertility symbol, curious remnant of old Druid practices. And on the reputed Druid altar stone, there is now a modern commemoration to Patrick. According to legend, it was here that Patrick converted the last royal holdouts of Irish paganism.
The monks of old spent a lot of their time making beautiful manuscripts with illuminations, but sometimes the monks used to dream. And I like this one that was discovered, written by a monk about his cat. It's called Pongar Bawn. It was originally written in Irish, but I'm reading an English translation. I and Pongar Bawn, my cat, 'tis a like task we are at. Hunting mice is his delight. Hunting words, I sit all night. Better far than praise of men, 'tis to sit with book and pen. Pongar bears me no ill will, he too plies his simple skill. 'Tis a merry thing to see at our tasks how glad are we, when at home we sit and find entertainment to our mind. Oftentimes a mouse will stray in the hero Pongar's way. Oftentimes my keen thought set takes a meaning in its net. Against the wall he sets his eye, full and fierce and sharp and sly. Against the wall of knowledge I all my little wisdom try. When a mouse starts from its den, oh, how glad is Pongar then. Oh, what gladness do I prove when I solve the doubts I love. So in peace our task we ply, Pongar Bawn, my cat and I. In our arts we find our bliss, I have mine and he has his. Practice every day has made Pongar perfect in his trade. I get wisdom day and night, turning darkness into light.
In the cells of certain chosen monks who had mastered years of careful apprenticeship, it fell to prepare the books for worship and for learning. The gospel writings were scarce and precious documents, which required the utmost care in copying. Only those most talented in the arts of illustration and decoration were granted the privilege. The pages were vellum, cured calfskin that had to be hand-rubbed smooth for writing. The Book of Durrow was created about 650 AD in a primitive monastery founded by St. Columba. It set high standards for manuscript illumination. This is the first page of St. Mark's Gospel. The symbols of the four evangelists preceded each gospel version. The lavish interwoven decorative animal design had become a Celtic tradition. It was developed to sophisticated perfection in later gospel texts. The magnificent Book of Kells is the masterpiece of Irish illuminated manuscripts. It was the work of many Celtic monks, scribes, and artists over a period of more than one generation. In it is fused the Celtic genius for elaborate patterns and fantasy figures with a bold original conception of the basic Christian message of man transformed. Some of the full-figure illustrated pages of the Book of Kells bear subtle resemblance to Eastern icon art. But the red-haired, rough-and-ready, mustached look of many of the pictured people show them to be sturdy, rustic, warrior Celts. The Book of Kells was completed in the early 800s considered the golden age of Irish Celtic Christian art. It has been beautifully preserved. Unfortunately, that cannot be said of the buildings. They were constantly attacked and leveled, first by Vikings, then Normans, and last and longest and most thoroughly by the English colonists, who cared little for Irish antiquities. What has survived of the major monastic sites in Ireland is often only a remnant of what once was here. The active period of occupation and use of these settlements lasted from about 500 to 1200 AD, a span of 700 years. Irish monasteries always were communities of separate individual dwellings. Each monk built his own hut. But these have mostly been casualties of the intervening years. The common buildings, the chapels and workrooms, libraries and kitchens, though mostly roofless and crumbling, can still be seen. The prominent round towers that look like farm silos were just that, in a sense. Places for emergency storage. The monastery valuables, ritual objects, and manuscripts were hidden here during attack or invasion. The surrounding rural Irish clans and kingdoms were often on the march, warring one against the other, and the monks were not immune. And later there were the fearsome Viking raiders to be wary of. Norse longboats could navigate the shallow rivers to the Irish hinterland, as here at Clonmacnoise, the place St. Kieran founded on the River Shannon. So these towers were a refuge into which whole communities often fled, to crouch in prayerful silence. Long ladders pulled high up inside shuttered elevated doors to wait, sometimes for days, till enemies were gone. When peace returned, the work of monastery duties could go on. Beside the excellence of scribes and illuminators, monastic metal workers reasserted the master craftsmanship of their Celtic forebears. They provided altar objects, storage cases for the precious gospel books, and chalices for worship. These plaques covered leather cases in which to store the books used for common prayer and reading. Fine gold work also adorned the staffs of abbots of the largest monasteries. The ceremonial cross of Cong is a superb example of typical woven Celtic patterns. The Arda chalice is a masterpiece of miniature gold tracery and jewel mountings laid over a silver chalice bowl. Local chiefs who sent their sons to school among the monks were patrons of their arts and proud to boast of helping gain them wealth. Sometimes the gold was looted from rival monasteries.
Is lonely. All that may will be as lonely as the statue sees. The lonely heart sings on a lonely spray. The lonely soul swings lonely in the sea. And all that loneliness is beautiful. All alone and all without a part is beautiful. For beauty is always. There is an eye is beauty, her heart is beauty. Breathing out on empty air, all that is lonely and is beautiful.
The most imposing monastic sites in Ireland are usually medieval additions to older foundations. Later stone testaments that capped years of development and struggle. The beginnings, though hard to find in still isolated surroundings, say much about the early monks' supremely simple and austere life. On Ireland's far west coast, the Dingle Peninsula, and on the nearby offshore islands, at a place called Skellig Michael, are the remains of so-called beehive monastic dwellings. hermit houses barely a man's height high, with crawlspace entranceways. These are stone adaptations of even earlier, more primitive mud-thatched cells. The earliest Irish monks were following in their own way the example of even earlier Egyptian Christian forebears. The so-called desert fathers of the primitive Christian church had fled the seductive opulence of Alexandria into hermitages in the Sinai desert. Something of their spirit reached Ireland through Patrick or his compatriots and spread almost as an indispensable feature of the new religion they brought. It is also likely that many who came here were Christian Romans seeking monastic refuge from the turbulence of their times. In places like these, and for many centuries, restless Celtic monks sought the heroic way, the most arduous and difficult path to perfection they could find. Here on the farthest edge of the world then known, they voluntarily isolated themselves in the most barren, lonely places for prayer and solitude. Some may have ventured from here to even further exile in Iceland, Greenland, or possibly North America. In spots where a small community of monks had gathered, these primitive stone churches also rose. They looked like upturned log boats, a first form of construction they probably were modeled after. Called oratories, they were also very small, with room enough for cramped use only when it rained or to store the ritual clothes and objects for worship. Around them were erected the first carved stone Christian art in Ireland. These were probably grave markers, crude pillars, sometimes flat, sometimes tending toward a cross shape, with elementary designs beginning to appear on some. Some show the marks of the agam, the early sculptured Irish alphabet of spaced lines that was soon replaced by Roman writing. The engraving and detail of these early Christian markers evolved slowly. There are hints on some of Egyptian or Middle Eastern symbols and motifs, but there is also the distinctive dominance of native Celtic style. The ancient Irish spiral or circle formed a base for the Christian symbols. The characteristic Celtic cross or cross in a circle asserted itself very early and rarely varied afterwards. Gradually deeper carving was done and pictures in relief were added. Ancient Irish decorative patterns, harking back to stone and Bronze Age work, were interwoven with the biblical themes. The end result was a highly refined tradition of intricately carved Irish high crosses, each uniquely and distinctively designed according to a fairly set form. Such crosses graced all monastic settlements. They were Bibles for the unlearned and places for communities to gather for worship. The carved pictures on the early crosses are primitive, direct, and charming. Certain Bible scenes are etched over and over again on the crosses. Why these particular stories were so important to the early hearers of the Jewish and Christian legends tells us as much about them as it does about their concept of the new religion. This is one of the first figures of Christ on the cross. The stone is worn down, but it is still possible to see the simple outline of a rather large, serene head and two outstretched hands. Jesus on this early representational cross is a man of dignified suffering. His hands are large, peacefully extended, his face composed. The angels hover near his head. The lance bearers beneath him, in contrast, seem to be the ones struggling. Each scene at the base of the cross is balanced and complete within itself. They are from the Old and New Testament and tell the events that were most important to these early Christians. In the top panel, Adam and Eve stand surrounded by a full fruit tree. A fat serpent is coiled around the trunk of the tree. This remembrance of the fall is found on nearly all the crosses. Below it, Abraham is sitting in a chair with a heavy knife poised to cut off Isaac's head, laid obediently on the table before him. In the upper corner over Isaac's head is the lamb God tells Abraham to use instead of Isaac for the sacrifice. God intervenes and saves Isaac. In the panel below, Daniel is seen surrounded by lions. His face and body are solid and peaceful. He is delivered from the lions by God's power. This is a picture of the three children in the fiery furnace. The furnace is shaped like a little hut or outdoor kiln. The leaf-like shapes above represent the flames of fire. Below, Joseph is leading a donkey carrying Mary and Jesus to safety. God has intervened to deliver them from being slaughtered by Herod's murdering soldiers. The loaves and fishes were multiplied by Jesus to feed the hungry crowd that followed him. An early Irish prayer asks, "Save me, O Lord, as thou saved Isaac from his father's hand, Daniel from the lion's den, and the children from the fiery furnace." The Irish carvers in their brutal and barbaric times may have been thinking quite literally of God's power to intervene in human affairs. They may have desired assurance that God would save them from murder, starvation, fire, the attack of wild beasts. On the other side of this cross are the favorite saints of these monks. The first two known hermits, St. Anthony and St. Paul, sharing bread on the desert. Later crosses not only have more story details, but seem to extend the desire for deliverance to another level. On the reverse side of each crucifixion scene is pictured the day of judgment, doomsday. There is no doubt that the carvers had a very literal and lively idea of what was going to happen on that last day. Irish Celtic Christian art reached a peak of creative unity almost 1,000 years ago. Whether in stone, in metal, or on manuscript, there was a common genius at work, a spirit of originality and imagination that mixed and flowed from one into the other. The themes were set by the thorough giving over of the Irish mind to Christianity and the monastic tradition. Christianity came to Ireland not by conquest, but on its own appeal. It came already clothed in embryonic cultures. Palestine and Egypt and the Mediterranean worlds of Greece and Rome had given shape and place to Christian history. In Ireland, the growing Christian world picked up a Celtic flair and an urge to travel. Well into the 12th century, the Irish and their Celtic cousins, the Scots and Welsh, were the new teachers of Europe. They were the founders of satellite monastic settlements where the Christian religion and Western learning were reintroduced to the peoples of Northern Europe.